was going to Nyack College, and I was studying there for a good time for ministry. And I had some friends at the school, very young, and I had some friends at the school, and this one friend, Denise, she had a friend named Monica. And so we're sitting there in science class, and she looks at me and she says, "Edgar, I got a friend. I think she'll like you." And I'm like, no, we don't do this. Blind date, that don't go, you know? Time passed by, Denise invited me to her church. She did not introduce me to Monica. Monica was up front on the stage, platform, podium, over at LPG. They were doing the youth service English thing, trying to get an English thing going on there at a Spanish church. You're Spanish, they Spanish. God has you Spanish for a purpose, to reach a certain community. Remember that. I'm serious. So she was there and she was just worshiping the Lord and she was jumping and praising God, curly hair, gray blouse, black skirt. Later down the line, we became friends. We emailed each other, and we became friends. And we were hanging out. and she noticed that I used to tell people, "This is my girl," and she needed to have a conversation with me. Because she was not informed that I was her girl. I knew she knew. And so she's like, "What's going on here? You know, are we dating or what?" And I'm like, "Would you like to be my girlfriend?" And she's like, "Well, yeah, at least you asked." And so we dated for some 4 years. You know, I believe in year two, Sister Tita raised her hand. In year two, Tita's like, "What's taking you guys so long?" We were taking our time. We were not rushing it. If it was real, it was real. That's what we believed. And it was real. And we got married. 4 years dating, 4 years of friendship before we got married, we developed a friendship. I married my best friend. You don't understand. A lot of people get married, but that person is not their best friend. Monica was my best friend. No offense, Felix. But you understand. Monica was my best friend. And we shared with each other everything. Even our shortcomings and our faults. Even our private sins. There's a lot of couples that don't share their sins with each other in fear that this one will leave me. But we had to be We learned that early on. So years passed, and we joined Crossroads. I was telling them, who was it? I don't know, it was PJ. And we joined the marriage group because we had some issues, financial issues and stuff like that. And so we joined the marriage group. And after we're done with the marriage group, me and Monica, we look at each other, we give each other a high five, and we say, you know what? We're not that bad off. We saw some stuff. But Monica's always been loving and caring, and it's an area that I lacked, okay? I didn't grow up with a father, and I love you, family. My family's here. But we were not always very connected, maybe the way we should be. And Monica took me under her wing. Yeah, she's my wife. She's supposed to be under me, but she took me under her wing. And showed me how to become a man that does not fear to love. Amen. And I'm not gonna lie, I still struggle with this, all right? This is an ongoing thing. Because when you're one way, it's hard to change, but change is possible. She continually told me, you need to be a better cousin and you need to be a better uncle. And I hope in one way or another, I tried a little bit. I've got a lot more trying to do. But she was a teacher to me. She's awesome. And so she battled cancer. Folks, when she was first diagnosed with cancer, when she first went to the doctor, she was stage 4 cancer. The cancer had already spread through her body. Stage 4 cancer is the last. That's it for you. That was almost 5 years ago. And she made it her mission. She made it her mission and her goal, not just to heal herself, but to help heal others. Because she felt a responsibility before the Lord to share whatever she was learning. I miss her. I miss her every day. It's not a day so far. I mean, it was just recent, but I've cried every single day thus far. I've cried today, I've cried yesterday, I've cried the day before, numerous times during the day. The apartment's empty. I can hear the echoes of my voice. And no one responds back. It's not easy. And I look at photos and I hear her voice through some of these songs. And I just wish she was still here. And this is going to go on for a little while. Continually. But I want to be strong like she was strong. She was faithful to the end. She used to worship the Lord. She actually used to wake up at the midnight hour and I would hear something and I would wake up and say, Mommy, you all right? And she was there. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. She was praising God. Even when she was weak, short breath, pulse of 130 per minute. Her very last hour of life, actually the last day, Yolanda got jealous. Because Yolanda says, "Bye, mommy, I'm leaving." And Monica didn't respond. Junior was like, "Mommy, I'm leaving." Monica didn't respond. And then I go to the bed and say, "Mommy, give me a kiss." And she goes, and Yolanda leans to my mother, "That's not fair, you see? Only to him, only to him." She was saving all her energy for me. In the very last hour, before she left, I got to brush her teeth. I got to tell her how gorgeous and beautiful she is, and with all her strength, she cracked a smile. She didn't have much strength. I knew it took a lot of strength for her to smile. I said, "Give me a kiss," and she puckered up. She puckered up. And I said, "Okay, mama, go to sleep, rest, you need your rest. Okay?" And she replies, "Okay." And I sit down. And the couch is facing her in the hospital room. I'm always vigilantly facing her. I don't face no other way. I move the furniture so that way it's facing her. She sleeps. And 20 minutes later, I noticed she was gone. No pain. And I say that not to comfort you. I mean no pain. She fell asleep and she went. And I thank God. She had no pain at all. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Continually believe what I believe, folks, because me and Monica have seen it for ourselves. Her death will not make me stop. Will not make me stop from believing in miracles. You know, events like this cause people to stop believing in miracles. They don't stop. When it's your time, the Lord calls you, the Lord called Monica. But to her very last breath, I believed completely. And when she was gone, I said, "Lord, I trust you. She's in your hands." I want to thank everybody here for just showing your love. Just the fact that you're here showing your love. In one way or another, all of you have met Monica, spoken with Monica, talked with Monica, been with Monica. Some of you in her earlier years, some of you in her later years. It doesn't matter when, but at least you did. You got to meet the most beautiful person I know. It's my baby. It's my girl. She played hard to get when I met her. I told her mother that. She was like, "Really?" Thank you. I appreciate you being here. I appreciate the church for being the church. Thank you. I thank the family and I thank everybody that has been there for her. So new chapter in my life, and I don't know how to live without her. 17 years, 13 of them married. I don't know how to do life without Monica. So I'm gonna have to learn how to do life all over again. And anybody that has lost a loved one, a significant other, you understand where I'm coming from. It's a new learning curve. It's having to deal with and cope. Those things that she used to do and I didn't do, I now have to do. And some of those things she used to do, I hate doing. But I'm grateful to the Lord. I was angry with him, I'm not gonna lie. I'm like, wait, what, wait, what? God is graceful, and he knows my heart.